Hey everyone, welcome to Mozilla Explains. I'm Xavier Harding, and today we're talking about open source AI and researchers and experts' ability to audit AI products. I'm here with Deb Raji, a Mozilla fellow and an expert on AI who's going to help us break it down. Hey Deb, how's it going?
Hey everyone.
So how would you define open source AI?
In the case of open source, you have all the ingredients to bake the cake from scratch yourself. but like with open weights or free software, like you're just given a baked cake and you can decorate it however you want and you can eat as many slices as you want, but you don't actually have the ingredients to bake the cake yourself and you don't actually know everything that goes into that cake. And so that is actually a pretty critical difference when it comes to auditing and understanding how the cake works or if the cake is good for you or not. If you don't actually have that full ingredient list, it can be really tricky to determine some of these things. But for like an end user or a developer user, you know, it might just be fine. You might just want to decorate a cake and you'll be fine as long as it tastes good enough. Those two views around openness, some people that are very strict about, you know, really wanting the full ingredient list and every aspect of the instructions, the recipe, and then other people who are okay with just receiving the cake and being able to customize it as they want.
So maybe we should just explain to folks, what exactly is an AI audit and why is it important?
For some reason, we have less rules around AI products than we do around a toaster. So a lot of the work around auditing is saying, okay, well, can we actually set similar requirements and articulate our expectations for these AI products? And then in the same way that we don't really trust those that are building these other types of products to have the best interests at heart of the consumer, and we have these sort of independent actors evaluating the compliance of these products to those expectations or to those standards, can we do that in the AI space as well?
You mentioned the toaster, and there's like regulation there to make sure a toaster can't catch fire and burn down your house. A company can't put poison cereal on store shelves. Cars are regulated. These are all things that can kill you.
Well,
I guess my question is, can AI kill you? And if it can't, you know, why should people worry about this thing that probably can't kill me? Should it be audited? Why should people care?
So the reality is that, yes, it can. ChatGPT and similar chatbots sort of embody certain racial stereotypes in the medical context that have since been debunked. But that sort of recent debunking hasn't actually factored into these models, or these models don't actually reflect on that in a way that is constructive to getting to the correct diagnosis. So it could become less accurate for one group versus another group, or contain a certain kind of racialized misinformation for one group versus another. So that's like one very clear case that is, you know, disquieting for me around the sort
of. Yeah, no, I was joking about the killing thing, but what you're saying is like it can actually determine your medical outcomes and medical treatment.
Yeah.
That is actually very scary.
Then there's also like another layer of AI deployment that is not necessarily used by the impacted population, but it's used by these institutional users. So for example, you might have a hiring manager or a firm that uses, you know, an AI resume screening tool, or a landlord that uses a tenant screening tool, teachers or academic institution using AI on its students. And in that context, you know, the impacted population is sort of separate from the user population.
Okay, so this is a question I have. So we've been using food analogies. I keep talking about cereal that can kill
you. Are you hungry?
I'm hungry. That's why I haven't had lunch today. I actually literally haven't. So maybe that is why I keep. But we talk about food and cars, and there's other examples too. You know, houses have to be built a certain way and people have to inspect it. People can inspect it.
Yeah.
Those examples we use, none of those examples are examples in the tech world. So is this sort of change AI auditing, is this maybe like unprecedented in the tech world? Is this impossible in the tech world?
You know, maybe a closer analogy would be like medical devices, or, you know, a lot of hardware is actually very strongly regulated. Electricity is very strongly regulated. When we move into software, I think people are a little bit wary of like, can you actually, you know, have oversight, you know, on if you have software as a medical device? This was a huge debate with the FDA, for a long time was sort of, okay, we have rules around physical medical devices. If you have, you know, software and you're using it as part of like a diagnostic process, like how do you think about that differently? And then now they're looking at AI machine learning as software as a medical device, where the pace of updates for an AI product is like much different from like a typical software product. So that kind of thing will change, but I think much of it will be the same actually.
And I love what you said about independent evaluation, transparency, and standards. It feels like you have a technology that affects society in such a broad scale, those three things need to be a part of it.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, sometimes it feels like the incentives are just to make as much money as possible.
Product safety has always been at odds with like profit, right? There's this book called Unsafe at Any Speed by Ralph Nader, who was really like the champion of, you know, setting.
Seatbelts.
Sorry, what do you say?
He's like Mr. Seatbelts. He's like the guy
Yeah,
who made seatbelts law. Because I think for a while, I think we may have been
exactly.
alive, or I may have been alive during a time where seatbelts were not the law.
Oh, really? Oh, wow.
Yeah, I think,
Okay.
well, I was born in 1990, but
I was like,
like, I
how old are
think,
you?
like,
I don't think you were
yeah.
alive.
Maybe I'm, but I think before him, you know, seatbelts were optional.
Yeah, like you know, the car companies really thought they were going to get away with it. Like they were, you know, building cars that the steering wasn't working, the Buick, you know, the brakes were not working, and he describes in detail like it was really like engineering negligence, right? Like they just weren't taking their responsibility to build these products constructively, seriously, because it's kind of quicker and easier to do a sloppy job. And it required a lot of advocacy to push back and to actually get us to the safe products we have today.
Deb, thank you so much for your time and your knowledge, and just, yeah, thank you so much for talking with us today.
No, thanks for chatting. This was very fun.
That is it for this episode of Mozilla Explains. What have you been using AI for? Let us know in the comments below. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to the Mozilla channel for more tech content. Take care.